Hello and welcome to another episode of PPC Town Hall. My name is Fred Valles. I'm your host today. I'm also the co-founder and CEO at Optmyzr. So today we wanted to discuss something that's been a little bit of a buzz in the PPC industry. Google's been doing a couple of webinars to tell us what to expect in 2022. And on one of those webinars, some statements were made that talked about TCPA maybe not being as cool or as useful as a lot of us have thought, right? A lot of us these days in PPC, we think about smart bidding, we think about automation. And when we think about automated bidding, for many of us, that really means switching over to a maximized conversion strategy, sometimes with a TCPA, a target CPA goal. Now, Google came out and basically said that using a target CPA may not be as effective as many of us thought it was, and actually wants us to maybe shift away from using target CPA. So when we hear that, that's a little bit shocking, of course, because we thought this was the state of the art. So let's go a little bit deeper on that topic today, and let's find out what Google really meant, what Google believes we should do, and who better to help us really dig into this topic than Google itself. So today we're very fortunate to have a couple of Googlers on PPC Town Hall. We'll be having a discussion with them, and they'll explain what they meant when they said TCPA may not be as effective as we thought it was. So let's get rolling with another episode of PPC Town Hall. All right, it says right there, target CPA is dead. That's quite the statement, right? So, hey, welcome to the Googlers on the call today, Alex Ioch and Rebecca Chiu. Thanks for joining us.
Absolutely.
Thank you for having us here.
Yeah. And Alex, you're returning. You've been with us before on the PPC Town Hall, so thanks for agreeing to come back. And we had some questions that were submitted by some Optmyzr users, so you're going to help us answer those today. But Alex, remind everyone who hasn't met you before what you do at Google.
Absolutely. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me back. I'm Alex Ioch, regional product lead automation in Americas, so specialized specifically on any smart bidding variations and helping our top agencies and customers succeed. So pleasure to be here.
Great. And Rebecca, you and I have been working together for a couple of months now, but I think this is the first time that you appear on the PPC Town Hall. So welcome to the first timer. Tell us a little bit. Well, I know what you do, but tell everyone else what you do.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm a platform partner lead for Google, and I've been working with Fred pretty extensively in terms of product solutions between Google and Optmyzr. So really excited to be here to talk about value-based bidding and what the next frontier is.
Great. And the listeners always love to know where people are coming in from. So Rebecca, where are you located today?
I'm located in Redwood City, in terms of office, and in Woodside, California, living-wise.
Right. So right here on the peninsula where I am too. So I'm calling in from Los Altos. Alex, what about you?
Same here. Same office, Redwood City.
All right. Well, all three of us are hoping for a little bit of rain at some point this year. I don't think we saw any rain in January, February. I get to travel to SMX Paris soon, and I'm going to see my family. And they requested I bring them some sunshine, and I think I'm asking for some rain in exchange for that. All right. Well, let's jump into it, right? So, the big question here, TCPA is dead. Like, what did that mean?
So to clarify, really not dead, right?
Okay, that's just me hyping it, right? Okay, but so yeah, if people aren't supposed to use TCPA.
Just a tiny bit. So it's as effective as it used to be. So by what we mean by actually moving to value-based bidding strategies is it going to be a little bit more effective since it's going to be aligning with your business goals. So I think that's going to be topic of our conversation today is looking at more of like your business objectives and how value-based bidding strategies, namely target return on ad spend and maximize conversion value, how they are better in terms of actually hitting your goals from the business side. So that's why we're encouraging, not that saying the TCPA is that, is more encouraging people to transition over from target CPA to target return on ad spend strategies. So,
right, and so TCPA is a strategy, maximize conversions. We're still gonna have access to that. But I guess the message is it may not be as effective as it could be for you. So there are other options. And so let's illustrate that maybe with an example We got this slide here. It's a Google slide. I've actually modified it a little bit. But Alex, do you want to walk, or actually Rebecca, why don't you walk us through this one?
Yeah, absolutely. So this just shows not every single lead and customers is valued exactly in the same way, right? So you may have a lead that's valued at 100 and someone who comes to you for estimate and took some kind of conversion action, maybe valued at 300. And the customer who actually transacted with you is at 500. So in terms of their bidding, in terms of value is so different. So you may want to set the way to bid for these customers very differently too, or for these leads. So one could be, you know, set at $5 versus $15 that really aligns with your business goals, because not every single lead and customers are valued exactly in the same way.
And I guess the crux of the problem is that, okay, so you're a lead gen business and your focus is heavily on target cost per acquisition, getting conversions. And so what you're communicating to Google, what you're tracking as a quote unquote conversion, is that first stage, the lead. But the point is that different leads behave in different ways. And some of them actually, you know, if you sell roofing, right, some people will ask for the free estimate. And then some portion of those people who got the estimate will also become a customer. And it's sort of those things that happen after the lead stage. So in classic target CPA bidding, all three of these leads that end up doing different things are valued the same because you don't look beyond that initial contact. And so that's why you're saying if you do look beyond that, now you can actually bid differently for them and bid more for the high quality lead as opposed to the, you know, the person who's just kicking the tires a bit.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right. Let me turn off my sound here. People keep interrupting. All right. So with that, how do people sort of shift into target ROAS? And by the way, have you guys seen any results? Like what happens for the typical advertiser who switches from TCPA to target ROAS?
Yeah, I think we actually have a slide for this one. So thank you for alluding to this one. So for in implementing them, you're like from switching from conversion values being strategies or target CPA maximize conversions, right? And by virtue of prioritizing different leads or different stages of your funnel differently, we see average uplift of 14% of conversion value with the same investment level, right? So you already had pretty tremendous, a good uplift from coming from manual bidding to smart bidding strategies, target CPA. In addition to that, coming from target CPA to target ROAS and maximize conversion value for that matter, you can see extra 14% on average, of course, uplift in conversion value. So pretty good results, and that's how it makes it effective by actually either prioritizing how much each specific person in auction for retail businesses brought to you, or actually different stages of the funnel, prioritizing leads maybe over calls, depending on the on your strategy, and actually telling the Google what's more important to you from conversion value perspective.
Right. And one thing that's fascinating to me in this is that TCPA has been so strongly aligned with lead gen advertisers, and TROAS has been so strongly aligned with e-commerce, right? But I guess that's the wrong way to think about it, right? So, and Rebecca, you were alluding to this, how it's really about getting as close to your business outcome as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. So in terms of lead gen, we see different people using different kind of methodology in terms of value of their leads. So you could go from a CPA to potentially cost of sales, ROAS, and then integrating your margin data to have profit, and then ultimately LTV. So aligning as closely to your business outcome is best. A lot of times, you know, given shopping campaigns, especially smart shopping campaigns, you have that value and transaction in a sales number already in terms of optimizing for target ROAS. However, we see in terms of shopping campaign, e-commerce customers, a lot of times they don't use target ROAS for search campaigns either. So we highly encourage people to actually look across all those different products in terms of Google, in terms of using target ROAS or max conversion value. And on top of that, in terms of lead gen, there's a proprietary, you know, CRM solutions, off-the-shelf CRM solutions, and other ways in terms of bringing some of that data into the funnel to look at exactly what the value of the leads are. So we definitely see a higher adoption rate from e-commerce customers, but we see opportunity across the board with different kinds of marketing objectives.
Yeah, absolutely. And then for lead gen specifically, right, it's not that it happened only in one touch. You have multiple touches all the way down to close deal. Or actually, if you track lifetime value of the customers, you can pass that information back, as Rebecca mentioned, even as simply as uploading for the spreadsheets, right? So you don't have to have any sophisticated CRM system to do that. And by virtue of passing that information back and, like actually matching against the data, what happened within the front end, you're going to be able to allow smart bidding strategies to target RAS or maximize value to go after more valuable to you customers. So importing that data will allow you to actually tell the system what's more important. And next time the similar person with similar attributes happen to be in an auction, then smart bidding strategies will know and predict lifetime value, like, or your conversion value within, you know, auction itself, person by person basis, right? Not only conversion rate as you do with target speed, but also conversion value prediction is going to happen. And by predicting that, you're going to have a higher chances of being more visible for the people who are more likely to convert for the bottom of the funnel. So that's a goal, right? Tell the system who are people who are more valuable to you. And as the similar people come in auction based on the data you provided, then we'll bid higher on them, make sure you win over competition, right? And then, assuming they like you and we repeat the process, you get more and more customers.
Exactly. And then sort of to put that into a different perspective, maybe, you know, say you're a bank and you sell mortgages, right? And you get all these leads for mortgages and you go from manual bidding, CPC bidding, like we saw, which is the simplest, and you switch over to target cost per acquisition. Great. All of a sudden, the automation gets you more leads, more people filling out the form at a lower cost per acquisition. And you're happy until the next month, you look at your mortgages and you see that actually you sold fewer mortgages. Why is that, right? It's the machine is getting you more leads. Why aren't they closing? Well, it's because you haven't communicated what you actually want. I run Optmyzr. I love leads for my business, but ultimately what I care about is people who sign up for the software. And that's very different from a lead. Like, the lead is one stage to get there. The free trial is one stage to get there, but that's not the end game, right? And so with the bank, what that bank should be doing is communicating when somebody actually is qualified for a mortgage and when somebody actually closes for the mortgage and can communicate that back to Google. And now the automated bidding systems from Google can actually go and find the type of traffic that matters to you. And so the beauty is you don't even have to worry about, like, what's the actual CPC bid that should be set in that case. Like, that's what the automation does. But you just need to tell the automation what you really care about, because if you don't tell it, it's just going to get you the wrong thing. So everyone listening sort of like gets this and is excited about doing this. I mean, it makes sense. It makes a lot of sense to me. So how do we go to get there, right? Like, what are some of the first steps in terms of getting started? So Alex, I think we have a framework for that. So let's move that slide here.
Let's take a look at more visually. But the first step is really to ensure you actually passing down the information back to Google, right? Sharing the better data. And again, don't have to be super sophisticated, but so those are some of the options you have here listed under share better data. So, you know, Google's site tag, so Google G tag from Google Ads account natively tracks really better. If you have an option for implementing any conversion tracking, privacy is super important for Google. So make sure you don't lose any conversions because all the disabled cookies or anything. So enhanced conversion will help you to add on top of that. If you have an ability, especially for lead gen customers, like offline conversion imports, right? What happens offline after after people submitted their leads, how do you track in your CRM system or in the backend? Passing that information back, it's really important. So some of those kind of highlights for sharing the better data. And the second stage will be really, once you do have it, ensure that you assign the correct values. What is expected value from each either stage of the funnel for lead gen or from different customers for the retail side? So that the system knows how you can actually prioritize between different stages or different interactions exactly. Once you have that information, you share the data, once you value them differently to prioritization perspective, right, then you can actually set bidding strategies to optimize what you're looking for, either return on ad spend or actually just maximizing in that conversion value.
Hey, and maybe we jumped the gun here a little bit, right? So these are all great things to do, but like really first step, or one of the foundational steps here is switching from maximize conversions to maximize conversion value with a TROAS. Or if you're doing this for the first time, choosing that bid strategy. But we did have an audience question, and people, and I've spoken to a lot of people who have this question too, but if you don't have a lot of conversion data yet, what do you start off with before you go into maximize conversions with a TROAS?
Yeah, it's a great question. Most of the strategies actually don't have number requirements for number conversions. And the reason is behind that is we know the intent behind the pool as the people are actually searching for products or such as yours, right? So we know the intent on the backend side is just a matter of how they look and how they work and perceive your brand specifically that we need to learn. So target CPA, maximize conversions and maximize conversion value. So the maximize conversion value doesn't have any required number of conversions. You can jumpstart it from the zero. For target return on ad spend, the only requirement is still there if you're coming, transitioning from manual bidding to target return on ad spend goal, then you have to have 15 conversions on the campaign level. That is being worked on to elevate on account level right now. So it's in the works. So it's good news there. And then we have zero eligibility beta you can enroll into. So you don't even have to do that.
What's the, sorry, say that beta again. What was that?
So it's zero conversion eligibility beta for target return on ad spend. If you're working with some of your Google representatives, ask for that one. It's been pretty popular. But again, it's only if you're coming from manual to target return directly. If you're coming from max conversions or target CPA to target ROAS, because we already learned information about user intent via those strategies, then they're like passing that information basically to target ROAS. So you don't have to have any conversions coming from target CPA to target ROAS specifically. So there's a zero number of conversions requirements there too. So most of the cases, straightforward implementation. So you don't have to wait. If you want to jumpstart with, if you just a cold start campaign, if you want to jumpstart with maybe target CPA and then transition to target ROAS, you can always do that. Or you can go with max conversion value at the beginning if you like.
Yeah, so maximize conversion value without TROAS or maximize conversions. Now, some people I talk to, they just want to go enhanced CPC or maximize clicks. I know that's not the recommendation, but like, let's specifically call that out. Is that just not on the slide, or is that actually something you don't recommend?
Yeah. So the issue is that you always can try that. The issue specifically, I think more with enhanced cost per acquisition is technically manual bidding strategy, right? So you're optimizing only 50% of your traffic and then still respecting all bid adjustments. So you're not necessarily learning all the intent behind the users. So it's not recommended because it's going to be still learning, much harder learning period transition from eCPC to say target ROAS once you have those data enrolled. So it's always easier if you already let the system know and learn is user intent, say if target CPA or max conversions or max conversion value for that matter, so that information will be shared with other bidding strategies, right? So, but if you want to jumpstart with max clicks, you can always do that. And again, but there will be, it's also not a smart bidding strategy. It's not optimizing for any conversion data. So that's why any automated bidding strategies and auction level, which we call smart biddings, like target CPA, max conversions, conversion value, those are going to be probably better option because you're going to be optimizing for actual conversion information.
Yeah.
And I just want to add that Google has incredible intent data, right? So we know how valuable each lead is. So if you're passing information, we see the most innovative marketers actually using max conversion value and target ROAS. You could go back 5 years to use maximize clicks, but it's not going to be aligned with your business goals that you want to ultimately get to. So we definitely
get you traffic for sure. No worries at all with max clicks, but is it going to be more valuable traffic for you? That's a question you should ask yourself.
Yeah, and I mean, what I always like to say is, how do you maximize clicks with a limited budget? Get the cheapest clicks. That's how you get the most clicks. And why are clicks cheap? well, you're not the only one in the auction, right? So somebody's probably figured out that click is not worth a lot because it's lower quality. That's why nobody's competing or fewer people are competing. That's what makes it cheap. So sure, you can get lots of clicks. But again, the story here is not, we don't care about clicks. We don't care about leads. We don't care about sales. We care about profit. We care about new customers, right? So, and then that shifts into the whole conversation, and let's go there next again, about communicating your value back to Google. So I worked at Google, right? And one of the 10 principles of innovation at Google, I think it was number 5 back in the day, was share all information. It had nothing to do with smart bidding or had nothing to do with running ads campaigns. But what it was about was, as a company, Google's a big company, lots of people work there. The best way to get all of these really smart people to work towards the same goal and move in the same direction without having to micromanage everything was to say, well, we got to share all information. If everyone knows what our goals are and everyone knows the information that we're using to try to get to those goals, then these smart people will individually maybe take different paths, but eventually they'll come to the same place. And it's the same with machine learning, right? And machine learning is a really smart capability, but if you don't feed it the right information, then how good of a job can it do? So that whole principle of sharing information applies just as much to the machines as it does to the humans. And so we have a slide here about different ways to share your data. So let's maybe take a look at this one.
Yeah, so it's really more of like on a higher level, like different ways you can approach it, right? You can, if you have a third-party platform, you can always use the or Google Marketing platform, you can use it for an API integration. But more so, the more common buckets is really online conversion tracking. So using the G tag or a Google Ads tag, global site tag, is also different names of the same thing for a Google Tag Manager important. So tracking that information. Or if you don't think, or like in addition to that, or instead, however you like or to organize it, you can also import your offline conversions, right? So what happens after initial first stage of submitting the lead online. So submitting that information there or getting the purchases. Maybe people are adjusting their values for retail too. So that's one of the other use cases.
Exactly. That's the funny thing, right? I mean, we call it offline conversion tracking, but it could actually be things that happen online. So someone going to your website and filing a return.
Exactly.
That's an online behavior, but that doesn't automatically get captured in the conversion data unless you actually push it back. So it's called offline conversion tracking or value adjust, but that's what that's about.
Exactly. So having this information is the first stage, right? So once we pass that information back, then the second is ensuring at the time of import or even within the interface of Google Ads, you assign different values to those different stages, right? So you can inform the smart bidding strategies what to go for and what's more important to you.
Cool. And then there's a funny little thing. So I think we're all familiar with the conversion actions page where there was this checkbox that would say include this as one of your quote-unquote conversions, which would mean it manipulated bidding. But Google recently changed it. I don't think they really talked about it. So we have a slide from it here.
Exactly.
So in that box, now there's like a primary and a secondary conversion action.
Yeah, so it's, I thank you for alluding to this one. It's definitely been a change from UI perspective, but it's more like, again, just putting in the different buckets, right? So the team is trying to make it a little bit more organized. So the way it's structured now is that you have a goals and under each goal, so goal could be like a purchase or a goal could be a leads, and say you have a leads as a goal overall category. Then you can have different conversion actions underneath each. And those conversion actions under each goal could be either primary or secondary. So the primary one will, if you enable that option, that will mean that not only you're going to track it as a conversion actions, like including conversions, right? But also inform smart bidding strategy to use that as in the bidding optimization. So that's exactly, they called it out here as an interface as well. So just if you don't want to optimize for that conversion actions, just mark it as a secondary depending if you're including account level or using it within the more of like a select optimization and campaign level as well.
Yeah. And then Rebecca, there's different types of conversion values.
Yeah, absolutely. So there's if you're just using, you know, Target CPA, for instance, there's conversion information that you could put in within this, but then static value, if you use conversion value rules for instance, you could assign an average value for people who took specific actions. So it could be across, you know, hundreds or thousands of that conversion actions of this type of customer or this type of lead. Dynamic value is where you actually pull in information for each customer or each lead. So this is a lot more sophisticated in terms of figuring out, you know, pulling in final sales value if you're e-commerce advertiser, for instance. And then the advanced dynamic values, a lot of times bring in the lifetime value. So if you have more sophisticated model in terms of calculating what the predicted lifetime value, when the person actually comes into you, pass that information back to Google, and our machine learning algorithm is going to get smarter based on the value that you actually pass back to us.
Yeah, so just to think about it for a second, right? You can import your profit into the Google and actually be to profit. So you can tell the machine learning to go and learn who are more profitable clients to you if you pass that information back.
Yeah. And so in that most sophisticated bucket, why not just wait for a year and then as these really good things happen, communicate your conversion back to Google then?
Yeah, I think for us, machine learning is, you know, you want the freshest data possible, right? So the quicker you actually pass it back to Google, the better it would be. Some of the offline conversion value, for instance, you could only port in information within 90 days after the click has been executed. So a lot of times you should try to pull in data as recent as possible. So our machine learning algorithm will help you to optimize.
And one more thing from from our PMs, right, who work on this one. So they really stressing out the consistency of passing information, especially offline imports. For the matter of that, any smart marketing strategy is actually going to predict your conversion lag. So if you have this recurring consistent import, so ideally daily, that the system will know, okay, on average, this type of interaction, say sales qualified lead, is taking this number of days actually to convert. So next time that similar person comes into the auction, they'll predict not only conversion value, conversion rate, but also like conversion lag. So that will factor that in because, we expected maybe it's between like next 2 weeks, that lead will actually fruit itself into something a little bit more bottom of the funnel. So it will know that. So that's why it's consistent imports are important. But if you have a broken one, it's kind of, messes up a little bit machine learning because you have like import one in one day, another one in a week. So it's going to be affecting your conversion life learning.
Right. So the more frequently you feed the machine fresh data about what's actually happening, that's great. So in a way, I guess it's better to have almost like fresher data, but maybe not the exact right answer. Like, mm-hmm. Don't wait for the exact right answer, but give like directionality to the machine, because that can also help it inform which direction it's going to go in. And I think that's kind of a big problem that we often see is advertisers get stuck on the perfection. Actually, that was another principle of Google innovation was don't let perfect get in the way.
Get it done, but perfect, I guess. Something like that. Yeah.
Exactly. Something like that, right?
Don't use perfect. I get in the way of good or something like that.
Yeah, exactly. That's it.
Move fast.
It's been 10 years since I worked at Google, so sorry, I don't have them like top of mind anymore. But exactly, that's the same thing here again. You don't have to have a perfect answer. Like, think about directionality. Like, was that lead just a little bit better than another one? And if it was just a little bit better, well, then tell the machine, because that means the machine can now prioritize that one a little bit more over the other one.
Yeah, and again, don't get stuck to an actual like nitty-gritty values, right? So if you have, say, calls, if you work for $10 and lead $50 to you, really changing to $51 that lead, I'm not sure how much of the data is going to actually impact to you, right? So don't get hang up on like really needy, greedy details of like conversion values. As long as the magnitude of difference between them is more important to you, right? $1 versus $5 or $10 versus $50 will be the same thing for machine learning, because I know which one to prioritize, right? So at the end of the day, it's still like ones and zeros on the back end. So I'm optimizing for that higher conversion value if that auction will actually entail that and having the people like that.
And you can always update the information as it goes along too, right? So for instance, I work with an advertiser that has a subscription business. So the refunds tends to come in within the first 5 days, and you could completely, you know, pass that information back and adjust that value as you get better and better data.
Yeah, as more and more stuff gets returned, which hopefully isn't the case.
Black Friday.
Did you return a lot of stuff?
You can hear your credit card statement after that. Yeah, for sure.
Well, and that was actually one of the problems this year. And so let's talk about this. But like, how do you correct these values, right? Because this year, Black Friday, so many people were worried about not getting the stuff they wanted. So I bought more gifts. And even like last week, I went back to Costco and I returned some of the gifts I ended up not needing, like 2 months after Christmas happened, 3 months after I bought it. Right. So how do you, and these are some of the systems that you see here on the screen for restating values. And let's talk about data exclusions for a second.
Yeah, so let's touch it out a little bit more, give it a context. So primarily use case, and Google really careful always communicating what to use and not to abuse it for. So the primary reason you should be using if something is broken from your conversion tracking perspective. So if your tag malfunction or you double counted or didn't count the conversions on that particular time frame, you can actually apply data exclusion for that period of time. Right, so that will eliminate basically that period from machine learning. So we'll basically skip that incorrect data you've been passing or not passing for that matter to Google Ads. So I think that's a primary use case. Other reason, and this is actually data exclusions, is I know we have a question probably from the audience is who might be curious of what happens actually from the seasonal adjustment period of time, right? So data exclusions are automatically baked into the seasonal adjustment. So if the, I know the Black Friday intent user is kind of unusual usually comparing to like the rest of the year. So if you do apply your seasonal adjustments, you think that you're within that period of time, your conversion rate is gonna spike double and you would like to be more competitive during that period of time through seasonal adjustment tool. So that will also have a data exclusion on the back end, so it doesn't impact the future learnings. And then once that period of time is over, then the machine learning go back to normal, essentially.
Yeah, so that's good advice on when to use seasonality adjustments and when to use data exclusions. And then the other types of things you see here, we did a pretty good, well, I'll say great blog post on the Optmyzr blog. So let me put that in a banner here real quick so you got the link to that. Just go to our blog and we have a really good description of the three different ways of adjusting values, whether it be offline conversion or value rules or value adjustment. All right, so next, the next step then is we were communicating all these values. So now we're actually going and turning on these campaigns. We did have some questions from the audience about campaign structures. And specifically, one of the questions was around, should we enable a DSA campaign at the same time, and where does that fit in? So that was a question from Chris.
Yeah, it's a great question. So if when you think about your structure of your campaign, I encourage you to think about as of your business, right? What are the buckets, either products or different intent, even if you're a lead gen, and how much those type of customers or interactions are actually worth to you? So approaching that from actual how much is valuable to you and how much return on ad spend you're looking for on the back end, right? So tracking that, how much you're getting that. So structuring your campaigns based on your goals. So similar maybe themes of keywords or similar products by target return on ad spend you're looking for. So it'll be the structure for your account. And in terms of the DSA, we do see different preferences overall in the market. Some people prefer to have a little bit more control for the budgets and return on ad spend goals for that particular campaign. So they break it up and it's in its own standalone campaign. If there's no strong preference, then you can create ad groups with the dynamic search ads within existing ones. So it's all up to your preference and how much you think you need more control for that extra layer of kind of catch-all bucket. So you need to remember the DSA is a secondary priority if comparing to regular search, right? So what you're not covering with your budgets, with your keyword structure, or with your match types, that will capture the DSA. So your search terms you cannot possibly think of. Like, I think 15% of the queries every day are net new, right? So you cannot.
Oh my God, did you just say that again? Okay, 15. Sorry about that. No, you're right. But like, this is it's probably like a 20-year-old stat from Google now. And for some reason, it never changes.
Well, not definitely not 20, but yes.
No, seriously, it's 20 years old. This is a drinking game.
We should all be testing on this one. It's still there, still official. So we still use it. But the bottom line is, you cannot anticipate all the different search terms in real time. So that's why the DSA will capture what you are not covering with your match types. Yes.
Exactly. No, it's a good point, right? Like, there's a reason that some of the old structures, like an alpha beta methodology, still work. That's why broad match has so long been really useful. But it is something that you have to manage, right? And so now in the day of automation, it's nice because you don't have to manage the bid of every single variation that comes out of a broad match. The system kind of handles that for you. And that's also a little bit the point that Google then often ends up making is like, you got to put these automations together. If you just use them independently of one another, then it may not lead to the expected results, right? Broad match is fantastic, but if you're bidding $50 for every broad match variation, like, that's not going to end up well, right? But if you combine that with smart bidding, and then you even combine it with RSAs, and we've done quite a few presentations on responsive search ads, right? But let the machine put the right ad for the right user at the right price for the right query. It's kind of how that all comes together.
Yeah, and one more point to remember is actually that the machine learning learns on this sort of search term level, right? So it's on the SKU level for your shopping ads and the search term level on the search site. So you can have different keyword match types within your ad group. It's perfectly normal now, even like have a separate DSA one. It will learn which are the more important search terms and associated data on the back end, those 1,000 signals who are tied to that search term, and actually learn from this one. So don't overthink your structure as much, as focus more on the more combining, giving as much data as possible. So more data and machine learning will actually learn who are the more important customers for you on the back end.
Right. I'm glad you brought up that point, because that's another common misunderstanding. So you positioned it as like it learns at the query level. The other place where people often confuse things is they think, oh, I have to have one campaign with as much data as possible because that's how my conversion data impacts that campaign. When in fact, it's the conversion action. That's the thing together with the query at one level and different things at different levels, but it's really the conversion action that's the fundamental piece of machine learning. And so if you have five campaigns and they all have the same conversion action feeding into it, yeah, they all learn from each other. And then the other thing, and Google has a great slide, we don't have it today, ready to show, but basically, even if you have manual campaigns, manually managed campaigns, and they have the same conversion action collecting data, those conversions will influence your smart bidding campaigns, right? So there's these interactions that people don't understand because it all goes back to the conversion action.
Yeah, that's why the important conversion values is so important, right? So tracking that information consistently over time will influence what target return ad spend or max conversion value will do. So that's why sharing that information is important.
We had another question from Chris, so let's quickly go into this one. But would you use different bid for portfolios for different campaign groups? And I guess this goes a little bit into the whole structure thing we're discussing right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so again, if there's a reason you're branching up campaign in a different, the different buckets, so having different campaigns, maybe per geographic location or different budget allocation, you can have portfolio strategies for a subsegment of campaign. A couple, best practices to keep in mind while you're doing that. If the goal is to ensure those campaigns you're bucketing together under bid portfolio, they have same target, right? So that's the one goal. Either you want to just maximize conversion value of those or like target return net spend. So if you have the same target return net spend goal for those campaigns, that's a good strategy to use it. But you want to watch out for inefficiencies, potentially what might happen on the campaign level from the budget perspective. So if you're bucketing under one bid portfolio, then you better ensure those campaigns are not going to be capped by budget, right? So if you're trying to hit 500 ROAS on five campaigns, but some campaigns become budget constrained, it will be harder for overall portfolio-based strategy to effectively hit that on all consistent over time. So either use a shared budget, it's going to be our recommendation if you have on those campaigns, or make sure they are just uncapped, so they're not going to be capped in on the individual day basis. It's not that, you know, we want to get more budget, of course we all do, but it's more of a consistently making sure the strategy is able to find those queries who fit your return on ad spend goal during the day. And if it doesn't, it becomes budget constrained, it'll become a little bit more conservative. It will try to not go into overly aggressive auctions during the day to ensure you hit the goal consistently, right? So again, making it a little bit more slower to hit your goal. So that's why if you're bucketing campaigns, so number one, make sure they have the same goal, right? Number two, they're not budget constrained or they have shared budgets.
Yeah. Hey, Rebecca, I don't know if you want to take this question, but Brett was asking. Brett's one of our frequent watchers. You and I have talked about this concern too, but so as we start putting more conversion actions basically into the system, like, is there a risk that people start inflating the numbers?
Yeah, I think a lot of times people don't understand that the conversion alley rules is measuring the incrementality on top of what Google already observed. So for instance, if Google already observes that the sales transactions are worth X for these types of customers and your LTV, let's say, is proportional to the sales transaction, then you shouldn't be using conversion value rules on top of that. However, if the lifetime value is twice as much as what Google is observing right now in terms of your sales transaction, then you should say, hey, 2X of these types of customers from this audience, from this geo, from these kind of devices. So there's definitely things that you need to read into the fine lines when you're actually using conversion value rules. And a lot of times also, you know, margin data, for instance, Google does not have information on your margin data. So if you want to put that information in, and a lot of the information could be indexed as well, if you want to keep that information proprietary. So we know relatively, these type of transaction has a higher margin of, let's say, 70% versus these values of 30%. So we're actually optimizing to your true value, business value at the end of the day, rather than just sales value.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, don't overthink conversion value rules. Is that it's only for cases that you're not communicating that information already to Google Ads. And most of the cases, if you do a full fine conversion import, you probably already have it, or even dynamically tracking your transactions. If most of the e-com already do, you're already communicating that. So it's only for edge cases where you think like maybe one location is more important to you from like lifetime value, and you don't have a way to import that lifetime value, for example, back or profit margin, as Rebecca mentioned. Other thing is that if you want to implement conversion value rules, so you're actually going to be able to segment it, and it's called value rule adjustment segmentation, where you're going to be able to see original value rule applied, original value rule not applied, and adjusted value. So you're actually going to be able to break it down to see how much in each bucket falls, you know, for within that conversion value rules adjustment.
Yeah, and the reason this is such an important question for a lot of people watching today is that you're still generating reports. Your boss is asking you, hey, how much value was driven? The moment that you start kind of like value rule adjusting it, these values are no longer what you intended it to be, right? They're helping the machine move in the right direction, but it's not what your boss wants to see in the reports. So like Alex is saying, there are actually multiple columns now in Google Ads. And so if you pull the right column data, you can still report what your boss wants to see in the reporting engine, but you can have the machine learning system use the adjusted values for value rules. Optmyzr has done a lot of work in this arena. So if you want to set better value rules, if you want to have these reports be clean, just reach out to our support team and we can help you with that. All right, so we don't have that much time left, but let's talk about some pitfalls and best practices, which I guess are somewhat similar to one another. Right. So, but we have a good slide of best practices, a couple of key things to keep in mind. So let's take a look at that here. Rebecca, you want to start us off on this one?
Yeah, absolutely. So the common pitfalls that maybe be there's a lot of different key metrics that you could focus on, but in terms of using value-based bidding, so you should focus on ultimately your max conversion value, your conversion value or target ROAS in terms of testing for this. So really keeping that to change, having your goal in terms of right metric is very important. The volume of conversions is important to give the test enough volume conversions to say definitively the test, you know, the experimental group is better than the control group, given your old bid strategy and your new bid strategy. Having that, we're recommending 50 conversions to basically make that call. A lot of times also learning period and conversion delays are the periods that you should exclude when you're evaluating performances. So it takes Google about a week in terms of figuring out the algorithm to optimize for your bid strategy. So excluding the performance during that learning period will help you to figure out exactly what the performance difference is between control and experimental group. And then on the conversion delays as well, it takes time for the conversion to come in, right? So sometimes even for lead gen, potentially it could take 2 to 3 weeks. So excluding that period at the end, so you actually allow time for those conversions to come in to really evaluate the performance values is really important as well.
Yeah, and so, of course, but those are expectations, right? So it's not like every single campaign is going to have 7 day of learning period or 2 weeks of conversion lag. So one thing you can actually check, and it's I wish they had a better way of intuitively knowing where it is, but once your bid strategy type, so where the name of your actually bid strategy, where it says maximize conversion value with TROAS, so that's actually blue hyperlink we can click and open up bid strategy report. So perfect. And it will look something like this, where you can actually see the blue line there. It will tell you how long your conversion lag is for that particular campaign, because it depends on your product, based on your search terms, is going to be different lag until people actually convert. And then Google, your conversion is recorded the day of interaction and respect on your, of course, attribution models. And if you have like more of a spinning wheels there or gray bars, is going to be your learning period, right? So take a look at that bid strategy report. Super, super helpful. Gives you a ton of information what happens, and then you're going to be able to adjust your window of analysis to see, are you actually hitting the target, and is your conversion value going up?
Yeah, so I mean, a lot of the same things we have to think about now, time lag, volume of data before we make decisions, like machine learning and automated bidding doesn't magically solve these things. Its job is to set the bids. It doesn't mean like it can get great results in 5 seconds as opposed to 5 weeks, right? So keep those things in mind. It also helps, by the way, to start with the TROAS that Google recommends, which is close to what you have been performing at. Again, there's like pie in the sky thinking like, hey, I would love to have 10,000 return on ad spend. Sure, who wouldn't, right? But let's be reasonable. Let's start with something that's a little bit closer to where we came from, and then let's optimize it from there.
Yeah, and then the reason why is because you want to start with the same competition level. Your TROAS is actually the level you can use to be more or less competitive, right? And you want to start with the same level you used to be before. Of course, you can adjust it, but it's going to be either more or less aggressive. And I would definitely encourage to use recommended level if you've been tracking your conversion values properly, because recommended by the settings level will also incorporate your conversion lag, right? So we'll factor in there's more conversions going to be in the future. So sometimes it's going to be really similar to last 30 days, but a little bit different depending on your conversion lag. So definitely take into consideration recommended in the settings.
Yeah. Cool. All right, so these are some best practices. I guess those lead straight into the pitfalls. So should we talk about pitfalls for a second, Rebecca?
Sure. Yeah, sounds great.
All right.
You have this slide on that one. Well, the first one is a lot of people don't include, actually a lot of people include the learning period and conversion delay period in evaluating the performance data. That's probably one of the biggest things. And then don't give enough time to reach a conclusive result. So you should definitely look at your statistical significance level when you're running these to make sure that it's getting to the level that you want when you're making a call, whether an Anubis strategy actually working for you or not. And then on top of that, a lot of times people make significant changes to their campaigns. And sometimes if you absolutely have to make these changes, then make it to the control group as well as the experimental group. But the best practice is actually to minimize as much change as possible during that time to give the algorithm time to learn and to fully test the strategies. The third one is what we talked about, Fred, in terms of conversion value rules. People think, oh, well, I should be value this particular customer leads from this region much more than this. But a lot of times smart bidding is actually observing that already through its algorithm. So those, if it's observable, then do not use conversion value rules to do it, but communicate incremental information and things that are not observable from a Google perspective.
Cool. Well, there you have it. TCPA, it's great. TROAS, way better. Value-based bidding, way better. Now you know why Google is saying that. We at Optmyzr believe it too, so we're building a lot of capabilities to help you with that. For those capabilities, you can reach out to the support team. You can read our blog. We did a recent post that you can see right there. So regardless of what type of advertiser you are, what you sell, what kind of leads you do, how big you are, value-based bidding certainly is the smarter way to optimize your account. So now you know, give it a shot. Google, thank you so much for explaining this to us and sharing a lot of great content. Really appreciate your help on this webinar and producing the blog post. That's it for this episode of PPC Town Hall. We'll be back in a few weeks. If you like these videos, subscribe, thumbs up these things. We'll keep doing more of them. We're also going to be making this available as a podcast. So keep coming back. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you, team. It's a pleasure.